I want to remind you, as you know, that you have microphones and you can feel free to ask questions afterward if you use those in the rear. But as we welcome Lucy to the program, I'll remind you that the full information about her was published online, but I want to highlight a few of those things. And I also want to mention at the beginning that copies of her book will be for sale in the hallway after our meeting for a cost of $26 per book. And thanks to the University Bookstore for offering the books for sale and for donating today's book sales to our Madison Rotary Foundation. I think I finally understand from last week the credit card is not accepted on this particular sale, but otherwise it's available and encourage you to consider it. I've only seen the cover, but I know from the cover alone that it's going to be a wonderful story. It has that feel to it, and I think we're going to learn a lot more about that in just a few minutes. And I think you know the story behind it, but I won't repeat that. I will tell you that Lucy has a wide and varied career, much of it using words in different ways. She has written and published poetry, short stories, and two nonfiction books, which were translated into a number of languages. She has been featured on the national television and radio, including CBS, NBC, NPR, and Fox, and is now right here on our stage. We're looking forward to learning more about the details of her research behind the story as well. The Los Angeles Times, San Francisco Examiner, and the Wisconsin State Journal, among others, have singled out this work for commentary. The State Journal, in fact, has named it the Book Club Read of the Summer. It's the Cherry Harvest. And Midwest Independent Booksellers Association, which includes seven Midwestern states, named the Cherry Harvest their Book Club Pick for July. American Library Association has written this debut novel makes a strong choice of book clubs for book clubs as it addresses a wide range of topics for discussion. Is violence on a personal or a global scale ever justified? Are relationships forged from necessity just as valid as those developed from emotion, for example? And I'm sure there are other questions embedded in it as well. And you can find additional blurbs on it online. I have one other piece of information about the family, I suppose, and the small world that it really is. Lucy lives in Madison now and spends some time in San Francisco, where she worked for a number of years. The Electric Power Research Institute in Palo Alto, for example, where she did a number of things, including international marketing and communications, and was the executive speechwriter and science articles for EPRI Journal, as well as communications for consultant. Has been involved in the executive planning board of the National Kidney Foundation's annual San Francisco Authors Luncheon as well. So a wonderful array of experiences that involve writing and speaking and communicating with people. I do know that from Fred Moes, that he and his brother Tom were actually employed by Charles Sanna, Lucy's father, some many years ago. I didn't ask him what he was doing or whether you even recall it, but Fred certainly did. So, smaller world than we think sometimes. But Lucy, we're happy to have you here, and we're looking.
Thank you, Ellsworth, and thank all of you for coming. Really appreciate seeing all these happy faces here. I also want to give a special thanks to Jim Rooley for inviting me, and to Lou Harned for introducing me to this austere group. So, thank you very much. Basically, let me get my little clicker. Oh, and another thing I want to mention, Ellsworth mentioned my dad and my grandfather. My dad joined Rotary in Menominee, Wisconsin in 1946, and he served as president there. And then when he moved the family to Madison in 1964, he joined this Rotary Club. And before him, my grandfather, A.R. Sanna, the one who employed Fred Moes as a lawnmower. he was a member of this club for decades as well. So I feel as if I'm among family as well as among friends. So thank you all. Now, can everyone hear me okay? Okay, great. Now, basically, this is a story behind this story. About 4 years ago, I learned that POWs had picked cherries in Door County, and I was astonished. I never knew that there were POWs in Wisconsin, let alone in Door County. Another thing is about it is they were mainly Germans from the Africa Corps, from Rommel's Africa Corps. And I immediately saw an opportunity for the kind of conflict that could make a good story. And that story became The Cherry Harvest, an historical novel. This is what it looks like, which launched just 2 months ago. So in writing a novel, you really need to get it right. So in order to get this right, what I did was I traveled to Door County with my daughter, and we stayed in the very place which I made family lives, my farm family lives. And I interviewed a number of people. I went down to the Door County Library. There's a room down there, a resource room that the librarian, Laura Kayakin, put together. It's just fabulous. And I went through the microfiche and a lot of reference materials. She also put me in touch with the Door County Historical Society. They, after I was done with the manuscript, reviewed it and told me such things as, no, we didn't have wild turkeys back then. So you really have to get it right, because if you don't get it right, you know, you lose credibility for the whole book. I also visited the Historical Music Society here in Madison. They were very helpful. And another thing that I did, the people at the Door County Library put me in touch with people who are actually here at that time picking cherries with the POW. So for example, one fellow who was very helpful was 14 years old, living on a cherry farm, and he picked cherries shoulder to shoulder with POWs. And he went on to become a horticultural expert. He's still living in Door County. And so he told me all about the way cherries were grown back then, as well as the whole, you know, his experience with the prisoners. I interviewed a number of people, including a widow of one of the POWs who came back. There's stories about that too, which you can ask me about if you want. But basically, and I got a lot of information from Fort McCoy, and you'll learn why in a minute. So basically, I put together some slides so that you can visualize. When you're writing a novel of another era, you really have to be able to immerse the reader in that place. And in order to do that, you have to immerse yourself in that place. So I put some slides together so to help you immerse yourself in the place and time while we're talking. So basically, whoops, we're a little bit ahead of time. Okay, there we go. So what happened was, in 1941, when the U.S. entered the war, the British had captured thousands of German soldiers. And the rumor came that Hitler was going to airdrop weapons down into the prison camps so that they could attack from within. And so the British said to the U.S., could you please get these guys out of here? So the U.S. reluctantly agreed, but where were they going to put them? There was no safe place in Europe. The war was moving around. The U.S. was also already supplying food and everything else for the British as well as the American soldiers, and this would mean supplying for prisoners as well. And they would have to guard them. So what they did instead, whoops, okay, we forgot about that. They brought them back to this country on returning empty Liberty ships. Now, Liberty ships were the ships that brought the supplies and the troops over to Europe. Once they arrived here, they traveled by train, and they went to military camps, military forts that were near train stations. One such one, one of the first ones they came to was Fort McCoy in Wisconsin. Fort McCoy is unique for a number of reasons at this time. They housed Germans and they housed Japanese prisoners of war, as well as Japanese who were interred here, Japanese citizens. That was the only fort that housed both of them. So they were basically brought from, a lot of them from California. By 1945, they were more than 425,000 prisoners of war spread across the United States. They were mostly German, but there were also Russian, Italians, Japanese, some Koreans, and some others. Now, they were initially housed on military bases. So as I said, Fort McCoy was one of the first. And this is a picture of Fort McCoy back then. And what they did there was they built a camp within the fort. And they called it Camp McCoy. It consisted of 35 buildings on a 20-acre enclosure. And it housed, as I said, a number of different cultures of prisons. There, I just recently read an article that the people at Camp McCoy were helpful. The things they sent me all said unclassified, so I expect there's some classified things down there as well. But I read an article about how the prisoners acted in the camp. And for example, the Germans and the Japanese were separated by a fence they could see through. You know, the Germans and the Japanese fought against each other in World War I, and they were not friends. And they would make faces and call things and, you know, all sorts of rude gestures to each other. But they did have to share the PX, the commissary, the barbershop, the eating facilities, and they sort of ignored each other there. But then the Koreans came, and they didn't get along with the Japanese either. So anyway, it was quite a feat, probably, to take care of these people. So they were given brown uniforms. Whoops, that's the camp. I'm sorry, that's the Camp McCoy. I'm getting a little ahead of myself. So that's the 35 buildings within a 20-acre. You can sort of get a double fence on the outside. Okay, they were given brown uniforms with PW stamped on the back. So at the time, they were known as PWs. That's what they were called back then. Now, most of the photos that I have are of the German PWs, because those are the only ones that were allowed outside the camp to work. The others were not. They worked inside the camp. I'll get to that a little bit later, but this is one very rare photo of Japanese prisoners of war. And the caption down there, I'm sure you can't read it, but it basically says that they are getting on the train just outside of Fort McCoy. They're going back to California to work in the fields, and then they're going to be shipped to Japan, where they came from. So they weren't allowed to work during the war, but it had to be after they had surrendered for this to happen. Okay, POWs, as I said, were put to work in the camp. Here's some German POWs at Camp McCoy. And then these are some Italians. They look pretty happy making bread there. That's in Utah. Here's somebody else in the kitchen in Arkansas. And what was going on outside of the prison camps was that the migrant workers who used to pick the fruits and used to work in the canneries found much more lucrative jobs in the factories. They went to the factories along with the women to replace the men who had gone to war. So basically, there was no one to pick the fruit, to harvest the crops, to work in the canneries and some of the other factories that were non-military factories. So what the Army decided to do, they realized, you know, this was a pretty expensive deal, housing 425,000 prisoners, feeding them, guarding them. And what they realized was that there was work out there that these prisoners could pay their own way. And so they contracted with the growers, with the canners, with the factory owners. They contracted with them for these prisoners to go out and work. And the prisoners basically got 50 cents an hour for working, but the Army gave them 80 cents a day so that they could pay their own way, you know, pay for their own food and room and board, et cetera. So here's a picture of one of the POW camps. These are the camps outside the fort. Basically, they put them in fairgrounds, on airports, on barns, in schools, and on migrant workers' camps, such as in my book, they're on a migrant workers' camp right at the family. Here they are arriving in Sturgeon Bay by train. And they worked in dairies, orchard. They worked in orchards. This is at a dairy. They were paid in scrip, which was only good at the commissary. So they couldn't bribe anybody. They couldn't, you know, escape with a lot of money. So that's all they had. But they were treated very well. The U.S. Army followed the Geneva Conventions, and unlike the way U.S. prisoners were treated in other countries, these guys were treated well. They had education. They're here, they're taking typing classes. They had sports equipment. They had a library. They could write letters home. A lot of the supplies given to them were given to them by the YMCA. So anyway, they really had no reason to escape until later, and I'll tell you about that. And according to the Geneva Convention, they also got certain things they asked for. So if they asked for, a lot of them would ask for books in their language, and they would ask for cloth to make their own flags. And as you can see here, this is Fort Sheridan, Illinois. There's a POW burial, and you can see there's a Nazi flag on the coffin, which seems pretty unusual to me. So why didn't we learn about this in seventh grade? Because the Army didn't want us to know. Well, you can imagine, people might have been frightened that these people were coming onto their property. Wisconsin alone held 39 camps across the state, 39, all over the place. And some of them had no more than a snow fence around them. What they did was the prisoners they sent out, they sort of looked them over and made sure that they were the safe ones. Another thing that was, I thought was interesting in the forts themselves and in the camps, on these other camps, is that there really weren't enough guards. I mean, the U.S. was at war, and you know, the men were over at war, and so there weren't a lot of guards for these prison camps. And so with the Germans anyway, did not work so much with the Japanese, but with the Germans, they relied on the commanders, the commanding officers, to command the troops, and they guarded the commanders, basically. And there's some interesting stories about some of the things they commanded, which I can tell you about later if you want me to. But anyway, so the Army didn't want us to know. They sent them to rural camps where a lot of citizens wouldn't have heard about them. There was a media blackout on this topic. The people in the rural areas needed them, and so they weren't about to run out and tell on them, basically. And when the war was over, the prisoners were basically sent back to their native countries, and the records were, for the most part, destroyed. Now, as I said, I received some things from Fort McCoy that said unclassified, so I would imagine there are some classified records, but I think the Army wants us to think that they were destroyed. So, you may recall that I said that the POWs, when they were here, they picked cherries in 1945. That's when they were picking cherries in Door County, and that's when they were doing a lot of farm work. Now, if you think about it, cherry season is going on right now. It starts in mid-July and goes to mid-August, pretty much, up in Door County anyway. They're later than a lot of the other places. The war would have been over, and that's the way it was when these guys were here. The war was over, and they were having fun, and everything was all hunky-dory, and the high school girls were, you know, making lunch for them and things like that. They were not supposed to consort with the prisoners, but there are a lot of ways around that. So that doesn't make a very interesting novel, does it? You know, these prisoners up in the trees having fun and everything's fine. Where's the tension? So what I did was I changed history. It's the one thing that I wouldn't give in on with the curators at the Door County Historical Museum. They said it was 1945, and I said, well, you know, I think I know that, but my story takes place in 1944. Okay. Actually, the first one of the first camps where prisoners actually worked was in Beaver Dam, and they arrived in 1944, so it's not stretching it too far. So anyway, then we get to my book, and I'll say a few things about it. Basically, After missing the harvest the previous year, say 1943, and this is in my novel only. In my novel, in 1943, the growers missed a harvest. And so it was a very bad year for them. So here comes 1944, and who's going to pick the cherries? Charlotte, my main character, 37 years old, farm wife, on the cherry orchard, hears from her cousin that there are prisoners coming to Beaver Dam and they're going to be working in the cannery. And so she first persuades her husband, and then she persuades the county to let the prisoners go, to let the prisoners up to pick the cherries all up and down Door County. And there is a lot of conflict in that because a lot of people, the business people, don't want that. They don't need the cherries. They don't want that. They're afraid. There are people whose sons have been killed by Nazis, and here we're talking about the German prisoners there. So there was really a lot of conflict around it. To increase the tension and the conflict, I gave Charlotte a son fighting the Nazis, and I gave the family a pretty 17-year-old daughter who would certainly get the attention of the prisoners. So what I'm going to do is read just the opening pages of the book, if that's okay. And then we can break for questions. If you imagine that your right palm is the state of Wisconsin, your thumb will be Door County, jutting into the depths of Lake Michigan. This far north, it's a short season of blossoms and fruit, so you have to come early. Come late May, take a low-flying plane from Cherryland Airport clear up to Rock Island, and you'll glide over 3,000 acres of pink and white fluttering blossoms. In the best of years, these trees supplied the entire nation with cherries. But that was before the war. Chapter 1. The rain came again, harder this time. Charlotte pulled her knit hat tight and pushed up the collar of her gray wool coat and stared through the chicken wire at the rabbits, Kate's prize rabbits. She entered the pen and chose a plump one, furry and warm in her cold hands. Its heart thumped like a tiny sewing machine. Charlotte brought it into the dim barn and stroked its fur until it calmed, trusting. She hesitated a moment, stealing from my own daughter. Then she picked up the butcher knife. When she cut the jugular, the sewing machine stopped. The muscles loosened and the body flopped open. Blood splattered and dripped from Charlotte's long white blonde hair. After stringing up the animal by its heels, she clipped the skin on the hind legs and pulled it down over the thighs and fat belly, turning it inside out like a glove. A ribbon of dusty light coming through the window illuminated the slick white body, front paws hanging as if in prayer. Charlotte lopped off the head. She'd chop it up later for chicken feed. The hide would serve as lining for a hat or mittens. Two of the mousers darted from the shadows and rubbed against Charlotte's legs, mewing, Lulu and Ginger Cat. She ignored their pathetic cries. It was their job to keep the rodents from the granary and compost heap, best if they were hungry. When she slit the carcass down the front, six tiny bodies slid into her hand, wriggling with life. Trembling, she closed the sink drain and pumped in water. She knew better. She should have palpated the rabbit's underside before cutting her open. She stared at the floating dead things. Not just one of Kate's rabbits, but seven. Shaking off the guilt, Charlotte placed the butchered animal on the cutting board and sliced it into quarters. She scooped the babies from the sink and chopped them into unidentifiable pieces. So I hope from that you can hear the desperation in what this farm wife has to do to put food on the table. Some of it's her own fault. because she's got her favorites. But anyway, I lived with my characters for 2 years. I said good morning to them every morning. I said good night to them every night. But now I'm closing the book on it. And as they go out into the world, I hope that you readers will take them in as friends, as I did. So that is where I'll stop, and anyone can ask questions as they wish.